So I got kind of close to her, and then in the summer after we had AP2, she had a picnic for our class up at her house in Hershey. And her house was built in 1822, and Bev just loved the house. And real nice girl. She's a lovely girl. And she's looking at me, and I kind of would glance at her, and she's looking at me, and you know, you want to say, "Why?" You know, and I kind of looked at her, and she said, "You need a haircut." And I said, "Did Bev call you up and tell you to say that?" Because Bev's been saying that. She said, "You look like a wild man." And when I had chemo, my hair stopped growing, and then it all fell out. And then what came in is this kind of bristly, steel, woolly stuff. And if I put water on it, it gets worse. So it ends up kind of sticking out. I look like Professor Irwin Corey, used to be a comedian on TV. Crazy guy.
I like the look of it. It's very Albert Einstein, very, you know, mad scientist.
My wife doesn't think that.
She has no appreciation. All right, so here's some of the things that I was thinking about that we could start with. And I know tonight, like, one thing that Bev and I talked about was having the kids just ask questions, like things they wanted to know about you, which might play into that history thing too, like stuff about the family or stories and stuff that you could share. But I was thinking that maybe you could share, I've put down just some funny things, like your most embarrassing moment or like something that you did as a child that no one knows about, things like that that'll just be sort of unique about you. And then some other things about like maybe sharing a favorite memory with each child or something that you remember that's a unique trait that you admire about each child or something like that. So do you want to start with one of those? Is one more comfortable than the other?
Mm-hmm, that's fine.
Okay.
Pick one.
Pick
just
one.
Pick one and go.
Yeah. All right. Let's start with share a trait from each child that you.
Okay.
And when you talk about it, share their name with it because so that they know who you're talking about.
Okay. A little bit out of sequence, but when I think about the traits that my kids had that really stood out when I was younger, if I start with Chris. He was very affectionate, and he was always kind of hanging on you, and I remember him as being exceptionally affectionate, and so every place we went or every place we sat, Chris was always sidling up next to you and hugging you and kissing you and doing those kinds of things, and it's a good thing. Dave, one of the great traits Dave had was that he was intelligent enough to know when he was tired. And of all of our kids, he would say, "I'm tired, I'm going to bed." And none of our other kids would do that. They would fight it until they got cranky because they were so overtired. And he did that his whole life. I think a trait that a lot of people don't have, most people fight it until the bitter end and then they go to bed. Dave didn't do that. Brooke was kind of quiet and introverted. And she doesn't seem to be that way now, but when she was a child, I think she kind of felt overwhelmed by all these guys around her in the family who were loud and boisterous and everything, and she probably wondered, where's my place in this family? And so I remember her as being kind of quiet and introverted. Grant was loyal. One of the traits that Greg had was that, with a couple of few exceptions in his life, he's been totally loyal to the family, and still is. But even when they were little kids, if someone would pick on his brothers or sisters, something like that, Greg would go way out of his way to let those people know that that wasn't going to happen on his watch. And so he's always been, we've always been impressed with his family loyalty. One thing I almost forgot, and I think it's important for us to remember this, Dave also had a soft spot in his heart, and actually all my kids do. They will pick up stray kittens and bring them home, and then worry about what to do with them. Where a lot of people will say, I don't want to bring a stray kitten home, because then I have to worry about what to do with it. They bring it home and then say, okay, what are we going to do about this? And I remember a couple of times where Dave, in school, there was a girl who had brain damage, and he used to wheel her wheelchair around all the time. This was in elementary school. And one of our neighbor kids was being picked on one night, and Dave got in a fight, and so he was put in detention. And Bev and I went down and talked to the school principal, and the school principal said he did the wrong thing for the right reason. So I think all of them have a soft spot in their heart, so I think collectively that would be the trait they all have.
Why is that an important trait to have?
I think when you have that trait, you're what we used to call on the farm good people. And when I was a boy, I met a lot of different kinds of people on the farm. Some of them were barely literate. And but they went out of their way to be concerned about other people and other creatures and did something about it. I think, I don't want to get scripturally maudlin, but I think it's an element of charity, and we've been taught to have faith and hope, but we've also been taught that the greatest of those three is charity, and so I think it illustrates that they have a charitable side to them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important for that reason.
What about one for Bev?
Bev's greatest trait is fidelity. And she is absolutely faithful. And she's absolutely faithful to me, even over periods of time when I didn't deserve that. And she's absolutely faithful to her kids and to the family. And really, when she gets tied into anything, if Bev attaches, so if she has a calling in the church, for example, and she attaches, and she does, you can absolutely count on her to do the calling. You don't have to call up and say, have you done this? Have you prepared this or anything? It's a person you can forget about and know that it will be done, and it will be done in a first-class way. She will do the absolute best she can do when she makes that decision to make that attachment. So I think it's a trait that goes past me, and it goes past her family. I just think it's how she lives her life. You know, I think part of fidelity is honesty. And Bev is an honest person. Sometimes you don't like to hear what she has to say because she can be honest. But, and we joke about that, and she knows we do. But she also knows that we all greatly admire her for that.
Well, I think
we want to hear what she has to say.
It's a family trait, I think. I don't think it's just her.
Mm-hmm.
I like how you shared the story about Dave, like, at school.
Uh-huh.
Do you have other stories about the other kids, something that you remember from their childhood that, like, when you think about it, it sort of makes you think of them fondly, or there's something that you remember from when they're a kid that, like, ties into, like, one of those characteristics, even?
That one just kind of flipped through my mind. I think Greg, over that period of time, in spite of some other things in Greg's life, he was also, I guess I mentioned this before, he was also very faithful. And when he attached to something, then he gave it his absolute best. And I remember one time his football coach, Greg was very small to play football. He was 5'9", 164, and played as a lineman. And I remember his football coach, his name was Pat Cahill. And Bev and I were talking to Coach Cahill one time. We had a lasagna dinner for the football team, and they all came up to our house. And we were talking to Coach Cahill, and he said, if I had 24 guys like Greg, he said, I would never lose a football game. Because he said he is absolutely resolute in his desire to do what needs to be done to win. One of the things I remember about Chris, in many ways, has talents that you can actually see.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can look at my children and say they're intelligent. But Chris is intelligent too, but also he has sticking out that he's very artistic. So he has something that's measurable. He could sit in church and amuse the other kids by drawing on the church bulletin and cartoons and things like this. For you too?
Yeah, of me, and I wasn't that amused.
Oh, okay. And so he would do that all the time. So he has this talent that it's, you know, it's very easy to see. And the other talent that Chris had was he was a very good actor. I actually thought at one time that he could find his way up at BYU and end up in acting, because he was an outstanding actor and acted really a lot of his life. A lot of his life was play acting and things like that. And but Chris has a fiery heart, but he repents pretty easily too. It might take him a while to do it, but he does repent. And I think you need to be able to do that. I think a lot of creative types are, they're different than the rest of us, and it's like there are differences between males and females and how they think about things and things. And I think we just have to recognize that. And when we look at the population, some people are just see life through different glasses than
mm-hmm.
I might, for example. It doesn't make them wrong, it just makes them different. And I think Chris was always that way. I think Chris is an idealist who gets disappointed or discouraged because things aren't the way they ought to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's caused him some angst in his life. I think he's worried about that too much. Thing I remember about Brooke, even when she was a little girl, she always wanted to have 5 or 6 kids. And when she was little. Well, she wanted to get married someday, and then she wanted to have 5 or 6 little kids. And she'd probably do that now, if economically and everything they could. Brooke always wanted to have a large family. She likes to draw babies around her. And when she draws the babies around her, then I think that satisfies her soul. And I think when she can't do that, she's probably not fully fully satisfied. So I think Brooke has a very, very giving spirit and probably feels that she doesn't have enough to stretch it around to. So she just keeps getting cats and dogs. And they become surrogate kids.
So. That's true. Did you turn around? Greg Christ did, yeah, I guess.
Yeah, it did, huh?
Is there a trait that you share with each of your kids? So, for example, when I think about my dad, there's different things that he's alike each of his kids in. I might share his stubbornness.
Mm-hmm.
And also hopefully some positive traits. But is there something that you would say that you, can you identify a trait you share with each of your kids?
Well, they're all good looking.
Clearly.
I told my class one time I wasn't feeling really good, and I was undergoing some treatment then, and I just looked really bad too. And I made some comment to them that I didn't always look like this, you know, that this was happened over the last 10 or 15 years of my life. Traits. Well, I think Dave probably exemplifies intellect and interest in intellectual things. He has a great interest in those types of things. And I think he exemplifies that. I think all of my kids are bright, but he's interested in those types of intellectual pursuits. I do have a temper. And I think Chris has my temper. It takes me a little longer to get mad, but when I lose my temper, I really lose my temper.
I can't imagine that.
I do. I have a terrible temper when I get mad. So because of that, I try to control it. Somehow, over my lifetime, I've ended up with an inner reservoir of anger that has probably never been expressed because of my personality. My personality is, well, you would never do that. You would just cover that up and hide that and deal with it. So I think...
Why do you think you have that?
I don't know. I've spent a great deal of time trying to think about that. I try to think back to my childhood and say, you know, did something happen to me and I have a repressed memory of it? Or, you know, because psychologists will say that's often the case. And, but I've pretty much gone, not day by day, but I've certainly gone year by year through my life, you know, and tried to look for any signs that there would be a reason for that, and it's not there. I think some of it is that I do repress my emotions, so that sometimes, I always felt that we have a cussing gene, and I will probably do anything I can do to repress anger and those kinds of emotions. So it could be that I've just built up a lot of emotions in my life that I've never really let rip.
Do you just think you repress anger or other emotions too?
I think it's mostly anger. But if you talk to Bev, she'd say it's other emotions. She would say he's very difficult to reach emotionally.
Huh.
And I don't think that's true. I think that in some areas I'm difficult to reach emotionally.
I wouldn't think it about you. I mean, I don't know you nearly as well as she does, but it's not something I would have thought.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't... I don't relate well to other people in certain areas. And I've tried to think of the way that I was raised. I was raised in a farm community, but a lot of those farmers are supposed to be like stolid and repressed and everything. But
stoic.
Wasn't that way at all. My mom was a big lover of her kids. She always used to say, "My richness is my four jewels." She had, there were four of us. And my dad was, he wasn't as open as my mom was, but he would certainly put his arms around us and kiss us and stuff like that. And
mm-hmm.
He was just a little more stoic than she was, but we certainly weren't left out there hanging emotionally when we were kids. And we were close as kids. As kids, we were really close. So I think I think sometimes I have a little repressed reservoir of anger, and I think Chris does too.
Mm-hmm.
He does too. He's well aware of it.
Yeah.
Brooke is basically shy and kind of insecure, and so am I. With people that Brooke knows, you might not really detect that, but if she's placed in a situation, she'll often say, "I just pray that they never ask me to give a talk in church. I just could not stand to do that." And they ask Emma all the time, and but she's basically shy, and I think I am too. I'm very relaxed with my family and close friends and things like that. But when I'm placed in a new situation with new people, and I'm expected to function in a way where I essentially evert myself and then start having contact with these people, I can't do that. I used to have to do that when I was doing research. We would have board meetings every year, and the board members and their wives would be up there, and these were all rich Masons. And what our administration wanted us to do was schmooze them, just walk around and just schmooze these guys all the time, and I could never do that in the 25 years I was there.
Shocking.
I would be off in a corner. And Bev often remarks, she said, when I was young and I was dating her, we would go to parties, and everybody would be having a good time. They would be, I wasn't married to the church, they would be drinking hooch and stuff like that, and just having a wonderful time. And she said, I would be totally off in the corner listening to a Bill Cosby record. He did one that I loved, to Russell, my brother, who I slept with.
Mm-hmm.
And having absolutely no interaction at all with people that were at that party. And I was very comfortable doing that. It didn't feel uncomfortable to me. The only time it felt uncomfortable was when I became an adult and was placed in situations where I knew I was supposed to have interaction and couldn't force myself to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Brooke is basically a shy, shy person. When she feels comfortable with certain individuals, I don't think that's apparent at all.
No.
But I think that's a trait that I have. That's a trait that she has. Greg has an eclectic interest. I'd mentioned before that Dave has an academic interest. He likes to know things. Greg wants to know everything about everything. And he does. And I did that even in my research. When you're doing basic research, what you do is find something that you're interested in, and then you run it into the ground. And you get grants and everything to do that, and that's how it's carried out academically. And I would kind of flit a little bit. The work that I did was good work. It was published in the best journals we have in the United States, but I would be interested in how vitamin A affects carcinogenesis, and then I'd be interested in these kinds of changes in aging fruit flies. And Greg is that way. He'll be interested in dogs that can sniff telephone poles and determine if they're rotten or not. And he'll read a lot about that, and then he'll be interested in Norse gods, and then he knows a lot about Norse gods, and then he'll be interested in cooking. And so I think he has an eclectic interest in the world around him. I don't think he ever really wants to know depth too much. He's had, you know, he's had friends, for example, that were from other countries, and he'll know a few words of their language, and he never really wanted to become proficient in the foreign language. I never did either. I took Spanish when I was in college, and we had a really cute Spanish instructor. She was from Spain. That's what I remember the most.
Incentive.
Mm-hmm. Senorita Matilda Mencia. And that was pretty much it. And but I never was really driven academically. Dave studied Spanish in high school, and then he studied it in college. And so well before his mission, he had an interest in, kind of an academic interest in Spanish as a language.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have that about a lot of things. I like to know why some flowers have to be pruned a certain way and things like that. So I think my interests are broad, but not necessarily, there's not necessarily great depth there. And it's kind of like you live a certain period of time and you want to know a little bit about everything. And I think Greg's that way too. And I think I'm comfortable doing that, and I think he's comfortable doing that. When I was doing research, I had to have some depth, or you don't get research grants. So I had to have some depth. But I would have liked to have been a dilettante of science, which you can no longer be.
Yeah.
So I think that's the trait that Greg has, probably, that I share places with him. Greg can get plenty angry, too. And like his dad, I can get plenty angry. But, scripturally, we are taught that it's understood that some people have tempers and anger. And what's required of us is that we channel that energy in a different direction. So it's not the fact that we get mad quick. What we have to do with that is channel that into something positive. And because we're probably not going to change an integral part of your personality.
Yeah.
You'll just bury it. And then just stick it down there someplace. So that's what I've done.
I'm not sure it's what I've done, but I need to work on that too.
Uh-huh. Do you have a temper?
Yeah, I think so.
Do you?
I don't know. I think not like in the scream at people or like just, but I will flare up, like feel rage at something, like,
uh-huh.
And then get over it really quickly.
Oh, okay.
But it flares up and then like something will just enrage me. And it, because I think I am kind of like Chris. I'm very emotional, and I think that there's ebbs and flows, but I forgive quickly too and repent quickly. Well, quick is relative, right? But
yeah.
You know, I don't hold on to it forever.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I think for sure I feel rage sometimes.
Okay.
Doesn't everyone though? Maybe not.
Well, that's what I feel. But if you talk to Bev, she would tell you, and the kids have noticed this over the years, that sometimes she'll say something or ask me something, and I crack back at her.
Yeah.
And then I know they talk about it.
Right.
And they know that I know that they talk about
it. That's family.
As family. And you know, they wonder why I do that, you know, that it will be nothing and all of a sudden it just comes out as, you know, like semi-volcanic,
can you answer the question that everybody wants to know, why you do it?
I don't. It's one of the things that I've really pondered for a great part of my life. As indicated before, I've even questioned, you know, was I abused as a child and don't remember it? And so I have repressed memories, and I don't know about all that psychology stuff anyhow, but I can't think of anything.
Yeah, I don't think it's always that.
I don't either.
If you could, is there anything that you would change about your life if you could? Anything that you look at and think, I wish I did that differently, or I wish I had tried this, or...
Well, I actually have one on both sides. If I could proactively do something differently, when I got out of graduate school, I would have gone to an institution where I could teach and do research at the same time. I went to a research institution, and I missed out on a teaching career, and I love teaching. So I think I missed something that would have been important and fun for me to be able to do. I make the argument today that my research career has essentially enabled me to teach the way that I teach, because I have a lot of depth in areas, and I have a lot of breadth in areas too. I have that eclectic learning that I've done through my life, and I've gathered a lot of that through my research career. On the other hand, if I was doing both things, if I was doing research and teaching, I would have grown in both areas at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I would be a better teacher today in terms of understanding teaching methodologies and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, as far as things that I've done in my life that I shouldn't have done, there are minor decisions that I've made certain kinds of decisions in my life, and if I could take them back, I would take them back. But majorly, when Bev and I were first married, we were essentially separated from each other as a couple. And were that way for quite a period of time, probably for 5 or 10 years. And, no, not 5 years, 10 years probably.
Wow.
And the reasons I don't want to go into, but I think over that period of time, that damaged not only my relationship with her, but it also damaged Greg and his relationship with me over that period of time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think Greg and I became estranged. And not because I was mean to him or beating him or anything like that, but I just was not available.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that had an impact on him later in his life. And if I could change that, I would definitely change that. That would be the major thing that I would change in my life.
Were all the kids born then?
No, when we first got married, we had Greg for 6 years as an only kid.
That's true. He's a lot older, isn't he?
Yeah. And then we had Chris, Dave, and Brooke in rapid succession, like a year apart.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think on top of the other feelings that Greg may have had, feeling like he wasn't part of my life and things like that, Then he had to deal with these three other interlopers coming into his life and kind of taking a lot of the air out of the room for him.
Mm-hmm.
And it was harmful for him. You know, I'm not going to excuse decisions he's made in his life.
Yeah.
People have had difficult things happen to them in their lives, and they've dealt with them in other ways.
Yeah.
But I understand, and I feel that, you know, I play some role in that. So if I could change that, I would change that.
Yeah.
Some of the other things, you know, there are little things I wish. I know when Bev's grandmother died, I didn't like her. And I wouldn't let the kids go to her funeral. And so there are things I don't think that are deal-breaking.
Right.
But certainly those things happen in your life, and you really wish you could wind the clock back and say, that was so stupid.
Yeah.
But you can't. But that would be the major thing that I would change. Another major thing, I would have come out of graduate school and gone to York College or someplace like that where they teach embryo research.
Mm-hmm.
And probably would have had a really fun time if I had done that.
What are the top three best decisions you've made in your life?
Well, looking back over my life, the best decision that I made in my life was when Bev and I did get married. I may not have felt so at the time, but it was absolutely the best decision I made in my life. I think the second best decision that I made in my life was probably when we joined the church. That was in a difficult time in our relationship, and I'm not even sure if we would still be married had we not joined the church. The church gave some form and direction, and I would look at some of these brothers in the church and say, I think I can be like them. You know, I think I can change my life. And I think I can be like them. I didn't want to be like the ones that were crazy fanatics.
No one does.
But there's just a couple of those. Most of the brothers in the church are really good men, and they really try to be good dads. They try to be good husbands. And I would look at them and say, I think I can do that. And I think the third best decision that I made in my life was when I decided to get an advanced degree.
Mm.
I think that allowed me to fulfill some of my dreams in my life, and in terms of gaining some knowledge and information that no one else knew by doing experiments and things like that. So that was really fun.
Mm-hmm.
To do. Ultimately made it possible for me to be a teacher. And so I think that was probably the third biggest decision that I made.
A lot of times when people are faced with like a terminal illness, you know, they even have the nonprofits and stuff out there for this kind of thing. But like, you think, okay, that I know that there's a timeline now. Here's something I want to do before I die. Do you have anything like that that you felt like, these are some things I want to do before?
No.
Really?
No.
That's so unique.
I said, I was talking to somebody one time, and we were, it was my oncologist, and he was in the room with Bev and I, and then there was another woman in there. She's a physician's assistant who is a go-between between the oncologist and patients. So if you have questions, you can call her, and then if she can't answer, then the oncologist talks to you. And we're talking about who we are, and he would always kid me, and he would always say to Bev, "I don't understand why your husband wants to be such a tough guy." And I didn't look at it that way. I felt like I was trying to put up the best fight I could. And I think little kids do that too when they have cancer. And I didn't particularly feel that I'm tough, but apparently I am, because when she went to our family doctor recently, he said, "You know," he said, "your husband is really tough." And I just didn't feel myself that way. And he kind of looked at me, and he was, I think, waiting for some response. And I said, "There's not much that I can say." But I said, underneath the skin of being an academic, which I've worn my whole adult life, I said, underneath the skin, I said, "I'm just a farmer." And I know I am. And I can tell because that's what my interests are. You know, my interests aren't to go to Cancun. It's to watch Penn State play football. And I can tell by what brings me joy and happiness. We like to go to the cabin where we have to fend off the bats and snakes are outside. It's we like it up there. And we go up as a family, and the kids can get dirty and no one yells at them or anything like that. They come covered in mud, and Brady spends 8 hours building a fire and getting sticks for hot dogs, and we just have a wonderful time up there. It costs us nothing to go up there. It's not like if we all went to Disney World or something like that. So I can kind of tell by the things that make me happy that when I saw a little more clearly the plank that I'm walking on in life, there was nothing that was triggered in me that said, "Well, I've never been to Algeria. I think I should go to Algeria." Or, "I've never been to Greece. I never wanted to go." Isn't that the strangest thing?
I don't know. To me it is, but to others, no.
For me, I remember a few years ago, I was out in St. Louis, and I was working on a job site in Cable out there as a safety manager. And I finished my work, and I went over to Illinois to the Cahokia Indian Mounds. There was a group of Indians over there back around 600 or 700. They built these huge mounds, and then they had the houses up on top of them. You know, they had a big mound where the chief lived, and then slightly lower mound where the medicine man lived. And that was just as interesting to me as if I had gone to Cancun and laid on the beach.
Well, it is more interesting than that.
Yeah. So I think my, I think the expectations that I always had in life were pretty mundane.
That must be a huge relief, actually, to get to that point and not feel like there was something you missed, to feel comfortable with, like, the choices you'd made and where you were and what you're doing.
There is. I don't feel rushed. I don't feel like sometime in the next 3 months I have to get this in.
Yeah.
I probably wouldn't enjoy it too much anyhow. I don't particularly enjoy food now, and so it probably wouldn't be like it would have been had I gone there 30 years ago. But I've always felt that there's just plenty to see in the United States, and plenty that I haven't seen, and that would meet my kind of eclectic needs. So I could see Indian mounds here and the St. Louis Arch there, and go to Florida and up in Maine, and been in Michigan, and I've been in Wisconsin, and just to, you know, I never felt like I was missing something.
Mm-hmm. Do you think we'll have Penn State football in the next life?
I hope so. And I hope the Savior is a Penn State fan.
He's not. He's Michigan.
He's Michigan. Yeah.
What are your most, like, can you pinpoint a couple experiences or one in your life when you, like, really knew that this, there was a savior, like, had a connection with God or something that, like, really made you have your testimony or something that was a powerful spiritual experience for you?
When I was a boy, I was raised as a Methodist, and I was raised in a normal Methodist family. We went to church and Sunday school on Sunday. When I was a teenager, I was in Methodist Youth Fellowship, which is like Mutual, MYF it was, and we used to go to that, and we'd have like a little spiritual thing and then do something fun, exactly like we do in Mutual. And I can remember when I was a little boy in that church, there's a stained glass window that's at the front of the church, and it has a picture of the Savior in Gethsemane, and he's kneeling by this rock. And the superscript on that is, into each man's life comes a Calvary that can only be climbed by prayer. The subscript is, but the cross he asked us to carry has been weighed with infinite care. And I remember looking at that, and I believe that. Even when I was a kid, I believe that to be true, that we have a Savior and that we need a Savior. And I also believe that we won't be incredibly overburdened, that we will face challenges in our life, but as children of God, we can handle them. And I think I learned that very early in life. When I became a member of the LDS Church, I didn't learn a lot of new stuff other than the role of Joseph Smith in restoring the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of a lot of new doctrine, my parents had taught me that doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
And it fell on fertile grounds because I believe that. When I got older, I didn't go to church. I stopped going to church. And not terribly uncommon, I think, when people are in their 20s or 21. And then when Beth started going to church, she was a member of the church. And then the missionaries hooked up with us. And I was always cordial to them. I never threw them out of my house or anything. They would come and they would teach me these lessons, and I would ho-hum it and thank them for coming. But I was always nice to them.
Mm-hmm.
Probably had repressed anger. But I was always nice to them. And then after I joined the church, I had an experience one time when my sister-in-law was joining the church. And she was married to Beth's brother. And she came from a very, very strong Catholic background. And they thought my brother-in-law was the spawn of Satan. And they thought he was a really evil guy. And they made it clear to her that if she joined the church, she was going to be written off from the family. They would light votive candles on her behalf, and then she would be just kind of written off and forgotten about in the family. So some people make significant sacrifices to become members of this church, probably to become members of other churches too.
Mm-hmm.
And she made a significant sacrifice to become a member of the church. Anyhow, my father-in-law baptized her, and she came out and changed and everything. And then in those days, they did it right after the baptism. Now they do it usually on the next sacrament meeting. But we confirmed her a member of the church. And I remember when we put our hands on our head, it felt like electricity going through my hands. And it wasn't just like a ting. It felt like this power going through my hands onto her head. And I think when I felt that, then that really bumped up my testimony, and I knew that not only was it really, but it was really real.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a real force that's associated with the Savior, with the Holy Ghost. And as humans, we interpret that. I mean, we're just interpretive kind of people. And I always kind of felt that because of her circumstances, she needed an additional confirmation that what she was doing was right.
Mm-hmm.
She was giving up her family. And I think the Lord probably knew that. And then the Holy Ghost made sure that she had that additional confirmation. And the confirmation turned out to be a physical manifestation,
yeah,
which I've never felt before or since. I've confirmed a lot of people, members of the church. I've set people apart, a lot of people apart. And I've certainly felt the Spirit,
mm-hmm,
but I never felt that physical. I can't explain it. It was just a kind of a funny feeling. And I think that's when I knew that, you know, you're driving home and you're saying, it's really real.
Yeah.
This is really true. And because I think you can go through part of your life and say, well, you know, this is the organization of the Godhead and this is how it functions. And, you know, you can make charts and lists and do all those kinds of things. That was the first time I had a manifestation that they really were there in that snapshot in time,
mm-hmm,
and were doing some kind of work that needed to be done.
Yeah.
Sometimes they do that physically. When Joseph Smith was in Liberty Jail, and he wanted to know, when's this all going to be over with? So the Savior spoke to him and said, don't worry about it. He said, it's just an instant in time. And anything that you think is terrible here is of no consequence compared to the eternities. And so I think sometimes there's an absolute physical manifestation. Or when Saul was walking to Tarsus and the Lord knocked him down on the road just to get his attention. You know, I think sometimes in order to accomplish his work, he'll do that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that was, I had a lot of experiences when I had leadership positions in the church and dealt hands-on with people that I certainly knew that the Spirit was there, and I would call them to certain positions or say things and blessings, and I definitely knew that the Lord was speaking through me.
And that's
that. That was the only time I ever had that electrically. I don't know what it was.
Yeah, that's pretty cool though.
Yeah.
My dad, I like vaguely remember this, but because I've never had an experience like that. But when I was little, maybe about 5 or 6, my brother knocked my other brother off the table in his little baby seat,
mm-hmm,
and he fell and he hit his head on the floor. And my mom grabbed him. He had this huge egg on his head, and my dad was luckily downstairs working, and so she went down and she grabbed him all panicked. And he came up and gave him a blessing. He put his hands on his head, and literally like, the bump went down during the blessing, like,
mm-hmm,
physically changed.
Yeah.
That stuff, like, doesn't happen very much, but it certainly is powerful when it does.
Yeah, when you're there a witness to it,
mm-hmm,
you know, you can't deny it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Bump, no bump.
Right.
You know, you just can't deny it.
People sure can come up with other reasons, but they can't deny that happened.
That's right.
So what's your favorite thing about yourself? Hard to pick among the many, huh?
Yeah. It's like looking at an extensive menu. I think probably my sense of humor. My family knows that I have a very good sense of humor. And actually, everybody in the family does. They all have a pretty good sense of humor. And, my sense of humor has flagged a little bit over the last couple of years. Sometimes I get distracted with other kinds of thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
But I've always felt that humor is important in your life. And although, you know, my original family wasn't particularly humor-filled. But we were within the family, you know, and but even when I go to our family reunions today, it's not particularly like people jumping up and down telling stories and stuff like that. Probably the guy with the most humor is one of my uncles, and he married into the family. He's a Welshman that he's about 86 or 87 now, and he married into the family, has a tremendous sense of humor. But, yeah, I think it's probably humor.
If you could leave the family with one piece of advice, what would it be?
It would be to just keep doing what they're doing. I'm really blessed with a close family, and my extended family is close. They call me and send me cards all the time, and so I have a very close family and extended family, and I'd advise them to just keep doing what they're doing. How they got to this point is, maybe it is the hand of the Lord, I don't know. Bev and I often say, there's really no good reason for our kids to be down here. They weren't raised here. Two of them went to school out west. They could have met Mormon or Western Mormon girls and ended up getting married. We'd see them once a year or something like that. And but we ended up down here, and all of our kids are within almost hollering distance of where we live. And we view that as a blessing. It's a great blessing. And I don't know if the Lord had a hand in it or not. But it makes me feel somewhat secure that when I'm not here, Beth will have the same support system she has now. And the kids are very supportive of her.
Mm-hmm.
They call her all the time. They get her advice. She's a genuine and integral part of their lives. And I think if that continues, that's what I'd want most for my family at this time.
To stay close.
Yeah, just to stay the way they are. And I see that happening because I think she's kind of the glue, because of the way she interacts with all of them. I can see, I don't see where that would change.
If you look at each person in the family, is there like a specific piece of advice you would give to them individually, or something you would say, you know, this could really make you up, from what I've learned, this will make a happy life, or something you would do individually, or do you think, no, just...
Well, I would say to Chris, you have to learn in life to truly let it go. You can't just say, well, I'm going to let it go and then not do anything about it. You have to truly let certain things go in your life and actually kind of turn the direction of your face and head in a new direction. And I think Chris needs to do that. I think he's allowing things from many, many years ago to significantly impact his life today. And I feel very sad when I see that happen. I can't do anything about it because he's an adult male and he makes his own decisions. But I would certainly advise him to do that. I would tell Brooke.
Oh, hold on one second.
Pardon?